Thanks for joining me on this week's 172nd Air Wing video review. Today we have a special Phantom in the mix. In continuing this month's F4 Phantom theme for the month of May in celebration of the F4's 65th year, we have HobbyMaster's 172nd scale rendition of what has to be one of the most famous F4s on record, at least in US service. This one is modeled after F-4D, serial 670463. For those who may not be aware, the numbers back here are not just here for sport, they exist to communicate important information. So the 67 denotes the fiscal year that the aircraft was built, and the remaining numbers denote the aircraft serial itself. So 67 was commissioned in the fiscal year of 1967, and it is the case on Air Force aircraft to this day. I will make a note here that the fiscal year of the airplane is not necessarily the year that it's put into service. There may be some differences based off of overlapping calendar year and months. So if you see 67, 68, or 05, or 10, that doesn't necessarily mean that the Air Force airplane in question was constructed that exact year. It may be a year earlier, perhaps a year later, based on the logistics and the flow of acquisitions. So this F4 is in the colors of the 432nd Tactical Reconnaissance Wing of the 556 Tactical Fighter Squadron, otherwise known and still in operation to this day in PACAF as the Triple Nickel. Among other pilots, This is known to be the aircraft flown by Air Force at the time Captain Steve Ritchie, who retired as a Brigadier General in 1999. Steve Ritchie scored multiple MiG kills with this aircraft. Note carefully that the six MiG kill insignias that you see right here on the intake splitter are not all from Steve Ritchie. Three of the six are from his sorties. However, other pilots actually scored kills as well. Pilots Dave Olmsted and Ray McCoy also got one MiG kill each in this aircraft. Actually, let me look at the record here. So with the MiG kills logged by this airframe, one was on 1 March 1972, one was on 16 April 1972, the next 8 May 1972, the other 10 May 1972, and the final two MiG kills happened in 28 August and 15 October of the same year. So this F-4 had quite the active year in 1972. And once again, three Air Force pilots would go on to be MiG killers in Air Force F-4D-0463, doing their part, as it were, to be the number one MiG distributor in Southeast Asia. So of the rendition of it, this is one of HobbyMaster's earlier F-4 releases, and you can tell by the color shading and the paint finish that they really did do a really good job with this earlier release. Seems like on some of their later ones, like the F-4D that I have, that I reviewed earlier this year in the Fucat 480th TFS colors, that one seemed to have more paint problems, especially along the nose with the demarcation line, which, as you see on this rendition of the F-4, is done properly as it should. So it'd be nice to see HobbyMaster get back to that level of detail on some of their newer F-4 releases. There are some other foibles to note here, because this is an older F-4 release. The accessories don't necessarily fit as well as they do on the newer ones, and the accessories are much more limited. Here you get the two pylons in the front, which feature two AIM-9, I believe these are the J models. The Air Force and the Navy use different ones, so one has to be careful when referencing the sidewinders used. But at one point they actually had a really weird dual setup where they would have two AIM-4 Falcons in the middle, two sidewinders on the outer rail, and then four AIM-7s and the belly positions on the F-4Ds. And I believe the 555th flew with this setup at one point just to cover their bases, because if one weapon system failed, well, they could switch to another. So if the AIM-7 didn't work, they could go to the AIM-4. If the AIM-4 didn't work, they could go to the sidewinders. And at this point in 1967, or I should say 1972, the F-4 squadron started using an all-sidewinder loadout for their infrared missiles. So as far as I can tell, this payload setup that HobbyMaster included is accurate. However, it would have been nice for them to have added a option with a pylon that does not have the Mark 82s on the triple ejection rail here. Would have been nice to see it with just the AIM-9s up here, as we see on several other F-4 releases that they've done. So as it comes out of the box, you only get this pylon combination, which has both the sidewinders and the bombs. So if you're looking at setting this up on a mid-cap mission, you're kind of limited in that, and I wish they had put another option for payload stores there. So to explain that a little bit further here, mid-cap missions are missions where the F-4s would fly to deliberately look for MiGs to engage. And it was a bit different than most of the flights, because most of the F-4 operations were air to ground. So they would have bombs, as you see here, and they might carry two AIM-7s or, you know, two sidewinders, maybe a self-defense, but their primary mission was blowing up something on the ground and going back to base. With the 555th, their job at this point in the Southeast Asian conflict was to kill MiGs, period. And they did a very good job of this. So I'm glad to have this in my collection. some of you who may already be aware of this, but if you want to see the real airplane, it is on static display at the U.S. Air Force Academy. And I believe the Collings Foundation did at one point paint their F-4D to match this color scheme. They have since repainted it to match Robin Olds's earlier F-4C, which is a decision I certainly won't argue with, seeing as how, based on the publicized record, I believe he is probably the first actual Air Force ace in Southeast Asia, if only on an unofficial basis, based on his memoirs and some of the publications that others have made around the at that point, the 433rd Tactical Fighter Squadron, 8th Tactical Fighter Wing. It looks like Robin Old was probably sandbagging his numbers so that he wouldn't get sent home right away and leave the Southeast Asian Theater early. The way he saw it, he needed to stay in Udorn and teach the young guys how to actually fly their F-4s, because as many of you know, and some of you may not, in the 1960s, Air Force F-4 pilots were not trained in air-to-air dissimilar combat, which to a modern setup, to someone familiar with how we do things now, that just sounds lunacy. But back in the 60s, the focus was on nuclear bombs and opposing a nuclear attack from the Soviet Union. So the emphasis was always about bomber interceptions. And as such, U.S. crews, both Navy and Air Force, were not trained in how to fight a smaller, lighter, more nimble aircraft, such as a MiG-17, MiG-19, or MiG-21, which is, of course, what the North Vietnamese Air Force flew in the Southeast Asian conflict. So the first initiation that many of these pilots had was when they got to the theater and started flying, which is not an ideal way to learn a trade like that, and Colonel Olds at the time knew it. So the way he saw it, with his expertise from World War II, he felt that he had a duty to the people under his command to stick around and teach them real air combat, as one of the practitioners of it and one of the folks in the Air Force at that point who could teach it. And the co-deployed Australian Air Force F-86s that were also stationed in Udorn in support of Vietnam operations also lent a hand by acting as stand-ins for the MiG-17s. And as I understand it from the publicized literature, the Australians gave a really good account of themselves against those F-4s. So I mention all that because Robin Olds apparently got a letter from the Air Force after his fourth MiG kill that once he got his fifth, which of course they expected any moment at that time, he would be rotated home and he would get a promotion to Brigadier General, a desk job, and he would go on a publicity tour. And absolutely none of those things had any appeal to Colonel Olds. So he kept his count at four, and when he shot down MiGs, he would either ask the crew chief to leave the gun camera film exposed for a little bit of time before handing it off to the intel shack, or he would give credit to other wingmen in his flight. So among other things, it's probably safe to say that Olds probably shot down substantially more than just four MiGs in his time, but four is what the official count shows. So not to take anything away from then Captain Steve Ritchie, but he became the first official Air Force ace of the Vietnam War, with logging five kills as well as his wizzo, Chuck DeBellvue. And Steve Ritchie is, of course, acclaimed as the first official MiG killer, but I think we can all safely say that he probably wasn't the first guy in an Air Force uniform to knock down five MiGs and rotate home. He just happens to be the first guy to officially get credit for it. So we will leave that subject and return to the aircraft at hand, the model of it. And as far as flaws go, I think if you're looking for this and you want to acquire it in your collection, I would definitely recommend it for the historical value alone. Plus the fact it is a really cool-ass freaking F-4. I mean, F-4, six MiG kills on the splitter. I mean, it just works, you know? So now we can get to some of the flaws. And the flaws of it are the pylons and some of the accessories fit very loosely. So you'll probably need to put a little bit of blue tack on some of the accessories and pylons to keep them in place, because this is an early rendition of the F-4 before HobbyMaster really dialed in some of the fit and parts attachments. So I'm glad to say that in some of the newer F4Es that I've acquired from HobbyMaster, that they happen to fit much better. So this is something that they've improved upon since releasing this model some years back. But because this is an early F4D release from them, there are going to be some foibles with making the pylons fit. Also note that because of the provenance of this model and its obvious history, getting a hold of one of these is going to be extraordinarily difficult. The only reason I got this is because a very generous forum member on Model Hangar 3, which I happen to be a member of, offered his for sale a couple of years ago, either just during or some months before the pandemic, I believe. So the prices, even at that time, the prices weren't necessarily reasonable. I think this was, I paid $170-something for it, shipping included, if memory serves. And yeah, you're not going to get one of these for that price now. I'll just say it right now. So if you're interested in adding this to your collection, just be aware that it's probably going to sell for a substantial amount of money. And if you look at the prices and think that it's probably, you know, too much money, I won't blame you, because I think the last time I saw this on eBay for sale was for the not short sum of about $230, shipping extra. So yeah, not an affordable choice at any means. But if you can get one and the price doesn't trouble your budget, I would highly recommend doing it. And I'm really glad to have this one in the collection. As you notice, there's some dust in some of the corners and you know, some of the areas of the model. I've done my best to get rid of that, to brush that off, but I do display this one, and I display it in the open, so you're gonna get a little specks of dust in there, and I do say that as a way of apology for those of you who might not like that. But I also mention it because this is one that I do display all the time, and I'm glad to have it in the mix, on the shelf, for all to see. So with that, we will wrap this week's video review. Stay tuned for next week, because we are going to revisit the circumstance of how this aircraft got its mid-kill on 10 May 1972 and some of the interesting aspect of Oyster 01 and Oyster 02's wingmen in the events of 10 May 1972 in next week's F4 Phantom review, which will culminate the series for May. So I will leave it there. Some of you may already have a pretty good idea of what F4 I'm going to review next based off of that hint, but I will say no further to spoil the surprise. So stay tuned, because next week, next Saturday, on the 60th anniversary of the F4 Phantom 2, you're going to see a review of a different F4, a different Southeast Asian U.S. Air Force mid-killer. So with that, we will wrap today's video. Thank you for watching, and if you are not a subscriber, please consider subscribing. That way, when I upload new videos, you'll be notified if you have that option enabled. I've got model reviews of a lot of different airplanes in my collection, all of which are personally owned, and they are not loaned or given to me or taken from an inventory. So they are all models that I have purchased with my own money over the last few years. So if you're, the F4 that you see here is not necessarily to your speed, I probably have a MiG or a Mirage or something that you'd probably be interested in looking at and maybe even potentially purchasing yourself. So hopefully you all found this video useful. And for those of you who are subscribers, I extend my humblest and deepest appreciation for your patronage. It's a way of showing me that you all care, and it's YouTube's way of you all providing feedback on my videos. So once again, I extend my humblest thank you to you all for subscribing. Thanks for watching.